Hello everybody and welcome to our Sunday service, and especially warm welcome on this baking hot weekend if this is your first time with us. It's lovely to have you worshipping online with us today. Coming up today, after our notices, Mel Howells will be bringing us our Bible readings. Alison Martin will be preaching for you. I'm going to be leading prayers and linking everything together with our usual mix of hymns and songs for you to sing along to. So shall we start with those notices? First of all, if you'd like more information about our services this weekend and over the coming weeks, about what's going on with the Blues Festival in Upton and how we're running a cafe in the church, do check our newsletter and the website calendar page and it'll tell you all about it. That's hopechurchfamily.org/calendar. And secondly, I'd like to invite you to participate in our online collection. Many of you do already give regularly to our churches, but if you don't, and you'd like to help us with the cost of our work in the community, the cost of providing these services and of maintaining our buildings, then please do visit our online giving page for more information. hopechurchfamily.org/giving. Thank you. Shall we be quiet for a moment and then we'll begin. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Would you pray with me? Blessed are you, Creator of all. To you be praise and glory forever. As your dawn renews the face of the earth, bringing light and life to all creation, may we rejoice in this day you have made. As we wake refreshed from the depths of sleep, open our eyes to behold your presence, and strengthen our hands to do your will, that the world may rejoice and give you praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. And why don't we carry on blessing the Lord now as we stand if we wish, and we'll praise our loving God in song. Everyone needs compassion.
Never fading, let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. You are that hope. Can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. You surrender. The mountains, my God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We sing it. The whole world see. We sing it for the glory of the risen King. Jesus,
Shine your light and let the whole world see. We sing it for the glory.
Well, do please take a seat and let's be still for a moment as we draw to mind those times this week when life has gone wrong, when we've let the Lord down or we've let others down. And then trusting in the promise of forgiveness offered through Jesus' death upon the cross, we'll turn back to the Lord saying, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And may Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, our psalm this morning is Psalm 82, which is a bit of a strange psalm, which pictures God as judging all of the other gods. Of course, there is only one God, so these other gods are people who set themselves up as God in opposition to the Lord. I'll say the odd-numbered verses. Why don't you respond with the even? God has taken his stand in the council of heaven. In the midst of the gods, he gives judgment. How long will you judge unjustly and show such favour to the wicked? You were to judge the weak and the orphan, defend the right of the humble and needy. Rescue the weak and the poor, deliver them from the hand of the wicked. They have no knowledge or wisdom. They walk on still in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. Therefore I say that though you are gods, and all of you children of the Most High, nevertheless you shall die like mortals and fall like one of their princes. Arise, O God, and judge the earth, for it is you that shall take all nations for your possession. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be for ever. Amen. Shall we pray? O Christ, the door of the sheepfold, may we enter your gates with praise and go from your courts to serve you in the poor, the lost, and the wandering, this day and all our days. Amen. And now here's Mel to bring us our first Bible reading.
The Old Testament reading today is from Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 9 to 14. And the Lord your God will make you abundantly prosperous in all your undertakings, in the fruit of your body, in the fruit of your livestock, and in the fruit of your soil. For the Lord will take again great delight in prospering you, just as he delighted in prospering your ancestors. And when you obey the Lord your God by observing his commandments and decrees that are written in this book of the law, because you turn to the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Surely this commandment that I'm commanding you today is not too hard for you, nor is it too far away. It is not in heaven that you should say, who will go up to heaven for us and get it for us so that we may hear it and observe it? Neither is it beyond the sea, that you should say, who will cross to the other side of the sea for us and get it for us so that we may hear it and observe it. No, the word is very near to you. It is in your mouth and in your heart for you to observe. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, thanks for reading that for us, Mel. Before we have our second reading, we're going to sing again. Why don't you stand if you wish, and we'll sing Jesus Shall Reign Where'er the Sun. Now, in a moment, Alison is going to be preaching for us. But first, here's Mel with our second reading.
Our New Testament reading is from Luke chapter 10, verses 25 to 37. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "What is written in the law?" he replied. "How do you read it?" He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? In reply, Jesus said, a man was going from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he travelled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have had. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, as we think of your words this morning, speak into our hearts, teach us anew of you, and help us to follow in your way. Amen. Amen. I was very tempted simply to ask Ron to start this reflection with a few bars of all you need is love and then sit down for 5 minutes. Because that's what Jesus' parable boils down to, love. Can it really be that simple? Does God actually make things too easy for us? Do we keep looking for the catch or trying to work out what we're missing? When really, it's as simple as can be. Both of our readings today, and indeed if we'd had the Colossians reading too, all suggest that God's requirements are devastatingly simple. Deuteronomy effectively says, how hard can it be? And I love those verses. Surely this commandment that I am commanding you today is not too hard for you, nor is it too far away. It is not in heaven that you should say, who will go up to heaven for us and get it for us so that we may hear it and observe it. Neither is it beyond the sea that you should say, who will cross to the other side of the sea for us and get it for us so that we may hear it and observe it. No, the word is very near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart for you to observe. Not miles away and complicated, but within us already. The commandment spoken of is to turn to God, to love God with all your heart and soul and mind. The very same that Jesus quotes to the teacher of the law in our gospel story. It is what it says on the tin. There is no hidden complication. Just turn to God with every part of you, and the answer is there in your heart. Simple. The lawyer who comes to Jesus wants a complicated answer to his question of how to choose God. He knows the simple answer, and he quotes it off pat. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbour as yourself. But surely that can't be all. There must be more to it than that. I think that he had hoped to sound clever and more deep thinking than everyone else. We're told he's there trying to catch Jesus out. But actually, he does end up sounding just a little bit silly and not as faithful as he might want everyone to believe. If choosing God is that easy, what excuse has anyone got for not doing it? So he asks for more information, and we're told that he does it to justify himself. In other words, for Jesus to produce a long and elaborate code of behaviour which the lawyer confidently thinks he already fulfils. That way, everyone will know how good he is, especially Jesus. And I rather think that he's hoping that Jesus will say in an admiring voice, "Well done, why can't everyone be like you?" But what Jesus does is tell a very simple story about the people who want to look good and like they do all the right things, failing dismally to do so. And I wonder whether he has that lawyer in his mind, the ones who do all the right things, follow all the rules, but are they actually doing the right when it comes to it? And then, of course, there's someone who has no pretensions, the Samaritan, who knows himself to be despised by the very man that he goes to help. Doing the right and indeed obvious thing, going to the aid of someone who needs that help. It's almost terrifying in its simplicity. Choosing God means choosing people. Choosing God means choosing anyone who needs you. No excuses. The lawyer doesn't pretend to misunderstand, but I'd love to have heard the tone of voice in which he answered Jesus' simple question. I'm quite certain it wasn't the answer he was looking for. He's being told, you can't choose the good of others if you are trying to elevate yourself to look superior. The fact that Jesus tells him to go and do likewise tells us that this was a hard lesson for him to swallow. Why tell this story unless it is a truth that the lawyer really needs to hear and to change his ways? Choosing people is about choosing all the muddle, the good and the bad that comes with them. Just as God chooses to love us with all of our failings. It can be so much easier to follow a complicated system of rules and rituals that actually keep us away from the nitty-gritty of living with other human beings. If it's so complicated that no one could realistically achieve loving God and loving our neighbour, then we would be off the hook. But as Deuteronomy and the Good Samaritan show, it's actually painfully simple. Loving God means loving those around us, who he made in his image, just as we are made. We show our love for God by loving our neighbours. Simple. All you need is love. And yet, you and I know just how hard it can actually be. Not complicated, just hard, to love others with all their annoying habits and different opinions. But the good news is that we don't have to do it on our own strength. And had we listened to our Colossians reading, Paul reminds the Colossians, a new church, who were sort of getting there, but just beginning to get a little bit fidgety and starting to find a few chinks in the armour. He just brings them back. And he reminds them of how they have learnt about the gospel, how they have cared for each other, and he praises them to remind them of that. And his purpose is to keep them doing this, not to overcomplicate things and find lots of rules and regulations to keep those they don't want out. And he says, may you be strong in the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience while joyfully giving thanks to the Father. So it's God's strength that we need. his eyes to see each other, to see each other's needs, and to reach out. And his eyes too, to see those who come to help us and be able to accept that help. And so we only need to turn to God to see his created children as he sees them, as any good parent sees and loves their child. And then we can love as he loves us and as we ourselves want to be loved. Amen. Amen.
Well, there's really only one song we could follow that sermon with, isn't there? The problem is, for copyright reasons, we can't really play you that one. So let's stand if you wish and we'll sing something else instead. Brother, sister, let me serve you. And let's continue standing as we declare our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Well, do please take a seat, and we're going to turn to prayer. Father God, we lift your world before you today. We pray particularly for the nation of the Ukraine, but remembering also Syria and the Yemen and other nations where conflict reigns. Father, we pray for peace and justice, an end to the slaughter. We pray you would transform the hearts of those involved in the conflict, to fill them with love and not hatred. And we pray you would work in the leaders involved in these conflicts to transform them too, that they may see beyond their actions see beyond their desires for personal gain to the good of their victims. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We remember nations that are in turmoil as well, Lord. We think of Sri Lanka, where the economy has collapsed, food and fuel are in short supply. We simply ask that you would provide for them. We pray similarly for Somalia, where there is a struggle with famine. Father, bring much needed aid to those lands. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for your church. We ask your blessing upon our bishops, upon clergy, and upon service leaders across this Diocese of Worcester. Help us all to proclaim. Oh dear. Help us all to proclaim the good news of Jesus, that lives may be transformed. And particularly, Father, we pray for the open air service in Upton this weekend around the Blues Festival, for the opportunity to share the gospel there, and for the opportunity to build contacts with the many people coming into town this weekend. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who are struggling with sickness and illness at this time. Especially we pray for Dave Forgan, Olive Latham, Andrew Hebden, Anne Butterworth, Brenda Parsons, Joan Halling, Derek Price, Mary Purser, and Betty in New Zealand. Father, we ask that you would strengthen them, restore them, and bring them to healing. And we ask your blessing upon the bereaved family and friends of Ros Renfrew, Robert Heady and Northcott, and Tony Parsons. Lord, you promise comfort in the face of grief. May those who mourn feel your comfort at this time. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And let's continue in prayer as we pray the Church's special prayer for today. Why don't we say this out loud together? Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is governed and sanctified, hear our prayer which we offer for all your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry they may serve you in holiness and truth to the glory of your name, through our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And gathering all our prayers and praises into one, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Well, before we sing our final song, here's a brief video from Bishop John about something that's really important to us all.
We began, I think, to appreciate how blessed we are with the National Health Service during the pandemic. We applauded it. We put out signs saying, "Thank you, NHS." And we really showed our appreciation. But it's so easy to slip back into taking it for granted, even though it's sometimes referred to as the national religion, the thing in this country that unites us all. If you were to ask, what's the relationship between the National Health Service and the Christian faith, which was the national religion of this country, and we could argue still might be, some would say, well, there isn't much relationship between the two. They have chaplains, but that's about it. It was the Christian faith which motivated the founders of the NHS. They saw the NHS as a kind of institutional answer to the question, who is my neighbour? The question that Jesus asked, which prompted him to tell the story of the Good Samaritan. And through the NHS, because we live in this civilized society which is based on Christian values, everyone is our neighbor. When an ambulance goes out to help someone in need, it's going on all our behalf to show that everyone in this country is neighbor to one another. I give thanks for the National Health Service. I pray for all those associated with it who give their lives to it. And I pray that we will all be grateful for it.
Well, our final song this morning is a wonderful reminder of God's amazing love and kindness to us. Here is Love Vast as the Ocean. And why don't you stand for this one if you wish? Well, thanks for joining us for worship today. Do please invite others to join us as we gather online and in person week by week. And if this has been your first time with us, I hope you've enjoyed it. We'll be here same time next week. And if there's any way we can help you on your spiritual journey during these strange times, do get in touch with me, barry@hopechurchfamily.org. And so may the Lord bless us and preserve us from all evil and keep us in eternal life. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Why don't we finish with the words of the grace?
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.